I'm Dr. Bhanukola, a consultant at the Center for Sleep Medicine and the Division of Addiction Medicine at the Mayo Clinic, Rochester, Minnesota. My article titled Medical Cannabis for Obstructive Sleep Apnea, Premature and Potentially Dangerous, will appear in the Perspectives and Controversies section of the Mayo Clinic Proceedings in June 2018. The title of the article gives it away. The main message of this article is that the use of cannabis to treat obstructive sleep apnea, or OSA, is extremely premature at this point with a very limited evidence base, and also that the use of cannabis to treat OSA can potentially lead to adverse outcomes. Recently, the Medical Cannabis Citizens Review Panel at the Minnesota Department of Health added OSA to the list of qualifying conditions for medical cannabis, making Minnesota the first state to approve the use of cannabis for OSA. The brief of support issued by the Minnesota Department of Health allows patients certified as having OSA to enroll in the medical cannabis program from July 1, 2018 and obtain medical cannabis beginning August 1, 2018. This was based on a review of about two animal studies involving rats, one proof of concept study in humans, and a recently published randomized controlled phase 2 trial also in humans. All utilized dronabinol, which is a synthetic cannabinoid, and an analog of THC, which is the psychoactive component of cannabis. This literature is preliminary, incomplete, and at times contradictory. For instance, in the first human study, there was a significant heterogeneity in response. Some patients with sleep apnea showed improvement, while others showed either no improvement or in some cases even a worsening of sleep apnea. In the randomized control trial, there was a statistically significant reduction in AHI, which is the apnea hypopnea index, which is a measure of how severe the sleep apnea is, and this was better at 6 weeks. However, the AHI was reduced by about 2 to 4 per hour. This is unlikely to be clinically significant. In this study, when response was defined in a more clinically meaningful manner, only about 15% of patients showed significant improvement. Obstructive sleep apnea is a highly prevalent condition that has significant impact on health. It can affect people's thinking, alertness, memory, and can also influence cardiovascular outcomes. Patients with obstructive sleep apnea have been found to have an increased risk of having high blood pressure, heart rhythm abnormalities, heart attacks and strokes. CPAP, or continuous positive airway pressure, which is the first line treatment for obstructive sleep apnea, is extremely effective. It's a simple machine. It adds moisture to room air, blows it under pressure, and can open up the airway. It can significantly improve sleepiness. It has also been shown to reduce blood pressure. Though not all patients can tolerate CPAP, a significant majority do. In those who do not, there are effective, well-researched alternatives such as oral appliances, upper airway stimulation, and in some cases even positional therapy. At this time, CPAP is still the primary treatment modality for OSA. In patients who cannot tolerate CPAP, their sleep medicine providers can troubleshoot and work with them to improve tolerance and adherence. A significant proportion of patients who initially start off by having difficulties using CPAP do end up using it regularly. In those patients who are unable to tolerate CPAP, they should work with their sleep medicine provider to explore evidence-based, rigorously researched alternatives. While there were no significant adverse events in the randomized controlled trial, there is a significant body of evidence showing that cannabis and even dronabinol can result in motor incoordination and sleepiness, which can result in accidents. There is also evidence to show that the use of dronabinol to treat OSA results in no improved cardiovascular outcomes. Furthermore, the way the Minnesota Medical Cannabis Program is currently structured, patients will receive either THC or cannabidiol or a combination and not dronabinol, which is the compound that has actually been studied. As stated in our article, based on the current state of evidence, we do not recommend the use of medical cannabis for the treatment of OSA at this time. Future research will need to look into the reasons behind the heterogeneity in response and help identify patients who might benefit. It should also examine long-term impact on cognition, cardiovascular health, and adverse events. Thank you for your interest in our article. I hope you enjoy reading it.
We hope you found this presentation from the content of Mayo Clinic Proceedings valuable. Our journal's mission is to promote the best interests of patients by advancing the knowledge and professionalism of the physician community. If you are interested in more information about us, our homepage is www.mayoclinicproceedings.org. There you will find access information for our social media content, such as additional videos on our YouTube channel or journal updates on Facebook. You can also follow us on Twitter. More information about healthcare at Mayo Clinic is available at www.mayoclinic.org. This video content is copyrighted by Mayo Foundation for Medical Education and Research.